So basically, as said, my topic is phaco in heart cataracts. So there are a lot of factors that you need to consider, particularly in such cases that you see in the picture, is how much is the pupillary dilation? What is the status of the corneal endothelium? So this, preferably in such cases, do a speculum microscopy if available. And if not available, at least do a good slit lamp examination. And with the specular reflex, you can check, look for guttae, particularly in case of hooks. So you don't want to miss out in such situations. You have to check for the zonular integrity, whether there's any phacoidosis or not. Particularly in such cases, zonules do tend to be a little bit weak. So the zonules tend to be a little bit weaker, and basically you need to, it's better appreciated in an undilated pupil. And then after dilation, you check if there's any zonular dialysis or not. So the morphology of the cataract also, whether it is leathery or not, whether it is a mature cataract, whether it is intumescent, whether it is hypermature, whether there are plaques on the anterior capsule or not. So all of that has to be considered, and posterior segment evaluation is extremely important because you need to explain the prognosis to the patient. So if the fundus is not visible with a 90D or a 78D, do an indirect, ideally you should be doing in all cases, and check nicely. And if there's no view at all, ideally you should be doing a B scan also, and that's good. So these things should be seen preoperatively, so it's very important. Coming to the biometry aspect, generally in such hard cataracts, the IOL master doesn't work that well. Hard and mature cataracts. So you can go for immersion biometry. If that is not available, contact biometry. The formulas that are generally commonly used are the SRKT formula and the Barrett's Universal 2 formula. In such cases, if there is a cylindrical component, you should be doing toric IOLs also. So coming to the intraoperative considerations, so you can have compromised visibility. And this could be because of the absence of the red reflex, and particularly if it's a mature, hypermature, so there'll be milky fluid, so it does have a little bit problem with that. CCC becomes a little bit difficult in such cases, particularly in intumescent lenses. It has a tendency to run over. There can be plaques, that could be an issue. You always have, sometimes you have the AC depth is quite shallow in such cases, so that you have basically less surgical space basically for manipulation, so keep on injecting a lot of visco. You can have corticocapsular adhesion, so hydrodissection is quite sometimes difficult and rotation can be difficult. You can have nuclear changes like the leathery fibers, which are very difficult to separate completely sometimes. So if you look at the anatomy of the nucleus, this is what it is. So whenever you have to consider before whatever you're doing in any phaco is that this part, the central part, is actually the densest part of the nucleus. So whenever you are chopping, whenever you're holding, this is the area that you need to chop. And when you're sculpting, so you need to follow the curve as it is taught in phaco, superficial here, and then you go deeper and you form it like a C shape, you can go in and do it. So capsular staining is extremely important over here, as I said, because of the poor visibility. So use Trifam Blue, keep it for some good amount of time. Particularly if you are just starting out doing, you should stain a little bit longer, wash it nicely. And if the pupil is not completely dilated, you should be using adrenaline also, dilated adrenaline, so that it dilates and gives you the best chance that is there. So another important step is multi-quadrantic hydrodissection. So you have to do little bit, go other multiple places and then tap in the center. This is how you. Otherwise, you'll break the zonule, so it's important to do this. And then, after injecting any OVD, what you need to do is then you need to check for the rotation of the nucleus. If it is freely rotating, it makes the job much easier. So, emulsification, you've got various techniques. You can have the divide and conquer, stop and chop, direct chop, trench and chop, crater and chop, and there are multiple modifications also for it. So, my preferred technique is the stop and chop technique. I don't do divide and conquer, but for beginner surgeons who are starting, it's not a bad way. You can do divide and conquer as well. And if you are starting off with brown cataracts or hard cataracts, don't do direct chop. Start in the initial cases. Do stop and chop. That is better. Once you're comfortable with stop and chop, and then you're doing direct chop in normal routine cases, NS2 to 3, then you can probably attempt it. But sometimes these nucleus are so hard, particularly because of the leathery nature of the cataracts, and the posterior plate separation becomes very difficult. So then you need to modify a little bit, as you need to do a trench and chop and or a crater and chop. So the difference between a trench and chop is you create a trench, and after that trench is created, you do a direct chop. In the crater, instead of the trench, what you're doing is you're creating a big gadha or a crater inside. So the trenching aspect is, you need to understand is that it's normally FACO you're supposed to do about one probe width. But in harder cataracts, you should be doing around 1.5 to 2 probe width. You need more space for such cases, and you have to do trenching still about 80 to 90% depth, and you can also make a crater, as I had said. So there are some intraoperative challenges that you can have in such cases, is that the CCC should be a little bit larger than normal. It should be more than 5.5 or more than 6 millimeters. About 6.5 is okay. The nucleus is quite big, so it's difficult to manipulate. Leathery nature is there, as I said, and difficult to separate the posterior plate. You will be using a lot of energy in such cases. So be careful. Do not do any endothelial damage and try to minimize your FACO in the anterior chamber. Your FACO should be in the bag or in the iris plane. Do not do any lateral separation. Too much. You can do lateral separation, but don't do too much of it, because these basically eyes or lenses, they have a very weak capsular bag, or the PC is very thin. So if you press too much one side or the other, it will give away and you can cause a PC rend. So therefore, you have high chances of PCR because of the reasons I just said. A good thing would be to practice the Arshinov soft shell technique. What you can, this is the original one where they're using a high molecular weight dispersive OBD like Viscoat or Orocoat. I have no financial interest in them. And then underneath this, they are injecting cohesive OBD. So dispersive OBD helps to, you know, protect the endothelium. And ideally, I do use in NS3 plus cases. I make it a habit. If the patient pays for it, I prefer it to you. Ideally, you should be using in all the cases. But because of the financial problems in of the patient sometimes, particularly in a setup that I am, you need to take care. So a modification of this would be, instead of using a cohesive, because you can't ask the patient to buy both of these. So you can just use a high molecular weight dispersive OBD like Viscoat or Orocoat, and underneath it, you inject normally HPMC. So this coats it nicely. This is extremely important because, see, endothelium is the most important structure of the eye after the retina. But if there's a nucleus drop, it can still be managed. The results of endothelial keratoplasty are excellent nowadays with DSEC and DMEC, but still you don't want to damage that endothelium. Moving forward, so what are the FACO parameters that you need to keep? So the FACO parameters should be, you need a higher flow rate in such cases. You need to have a higher vacuum. Particularly, I would suggest, suppose if you're using, for beginner surgeons, you're doing around 350 to 370, increase the vacuum to about 400, 420 or something. I prefer to use the panel mode in my route, all cases except, I use the panel mode. The difference between panel mode and the linear mode is that the panel is like an on-off switch. So you just press on and the maximum vacuum comes, and you just take off your foot off the pedal and it's zero. So, but in linear thing is it gradually builds up. You need more FACO power in such cases. So don't be afraid to go to 80% FACO power or 90% FACO power also. Remember that if you're trenching, if there is any pushing effect on the lens, that means your power is insufficient and hence you need to increase the power. Any pushing effect will or can compromise the zonules a little bit. So doesn't matter if you're using 80-90% power, no pushing effect on the nucleus. And then for trenching, it can be different. For trenching, obviously, you don't need a vacuum. But my point of saying higher vacuum is in cases of chopping. For trenching, you don't need vacuum much. Around 40 or 60 is enough. So let's go to some cases. So this first case is a stop and chop FACO that I am showing. So over here, again, this is a full case that I'm showing. After staining, I have injected OVD inside the eye. And this is a brown cataract. A keratome entry is made, clear corneal entry. OVD is injected. And so you can see the lens is slightly intumescent also. You feel the lens is intumescent. So this is probably a topical case. So there is some milky fluid that is coming in. So you have to be careful you know, very, very careful in doing these rexes in such situations. The rexes is one of the most important things when you're doing FAPO. So as you can see, I'm making a smaller rexes right now because I feel, you know, this can easily extend to the periphery. So these are mostly unedited videos or minimal editing has been done that I'm showing today without any increasing the speed or anything. And you have to sometimes go and use the Utrata forceps or a micro rexes forceps, whatever is available with you at that time. So once this is done, then you can make, okay, still completing that. So sometimes you need to change your incisions as to where you're doing it. And okay, so this is done. The next thing is, would be you need to take out this this matter that is there, which is because of which the chances of extension are there. I'll be discussing this about it in the complication part in the later stages. So this is done. So you can use a Simco cannula, you can use a bimanual irrigation aspiration cannula, whatever you're comfortable with, it's fine. Just be careful not to touch the iris too much or the pupil will constrict. So once this is done, then after injecting, see again and again, you have to inject OBD inside such eyes. A cut is made. So this is an example of a double rexus that I'm showing you. A tangential cut is made. And then again, using this is the normal Utrata forceps that I'm using. And then this rexus is made bigger. Okay. I feel it's a little bit smaller side for such a grade of cataract. So then I made another cut at the other side. And again, using the same maneuver, Utrata forceps is used to increase the size of the rexus. Nazmul, is the video streaming okay?
Yes, sir. It is perfect, sir.
Okay. So this is done. Now the next part is, again, over here is that you should be injecting OVD and you should be using a highly high molecular weight dispersive OVD to coat the endothelium. That is done, and then FACO is started. So here I'll be doing a stop and chop. So see, I'm making a slightly bigger one. Even if it is rotating towards one side, it's okay. It's kind of like a crater only, but so you have to go to about 80 to 90% depth. A lot of people use two hands to separate the two nuclei when it's created in stop and chop. I prefer to use the FACO Pro because, you know, the irrigation is on. So, and it's not that difficult. And then once the crack is done, we rotate it and check for the other side. It's other side. To separate the posterior plate. Once you have done with that, surgery actually becomes a little bit more easier. If that plate is not separated, the nucleus pieces, as I'll show a video of that later on, it becomes more difficult, more challenging, because you're eating little a part of it and the other thing comes. So then you go inside the hard nucleus in this middle part, and then this is a vertical chop that I have done. Similarly, on the other side, I've done a vertical chop, and basically then you eat it up. So some people prefer to make multiple small pieces and then eat it. Eat a little bit more, and this basically gives me space to manipulate a little bit more. So once this is done, you can see again, you have to chop once whenever there is occlusion, chop it into multiple smaller pieces. It will make your life much, much easier. Again and again, I'm putting OVD inside the eye, and specifically somebody is doing after every quadrant that you've done, inject some higher molecular weight dispersive OVD, because you don't want post-operative condyloedema, and it is a high chance in such cases. So then this part is, you have to hold it in the center of the main part, of the thickest part. And that is when you can chop. If there is not, if it's superficial, you will not be able to separate posteriorly till the posterior plate, and there will be the chopping will not be great. So you have to hold in the most densest part of the nucleus. And in such cataracts, you give a little bit power, go inside the nucleus, and then do occlusion and then hold the nucleus. Okay. So in such cases, a good idea for the beginner surgeons is what I'm doing right now is inject OVD inside to push the bag back. Because surge can happen in such cases, particularly when you're using high fluidics, and use the second hand for that. And once that is done, then it becomes a little bit more easy and you can just eat this part out. See, the phaco has to always be done in the center of the eye. Do not do in the periphery, because you will catch hold of the iris and you don't want that, you know, makes the surgery look bad, complicated, again, stuff like that. Once this is done, again, see, this is the practice, particularly for beginner surgeons who should be practicing it, is don't let the AC collapse. With the second instrument, you can go inside. And cortex aspiration in such cases, you can have some cells that are remaining behind, some sticky fibers. So use the polishing mode when it's not aspirating and, you know, clean it all nicely. So once this is done, the IOL was implanted in the back, the case did well. This is another case. Now this case, basically what I'm doing is I'll be showing crater and chop. So again, see, so I'm basically creating a big crater. You can either do this or you can make a trench and then directly chop it. So again, a big crater is made over here. Okay. Yeah. So once this is done, wait, I skipped the chopping part. Yeah. So the crater is made, and then in that crater only I'm going to go. And I'm going to chop it. This is a vertical chop that I'm doing. So you, in hard cataracts, you need to sometimes use a combination of horizontal, vertical chopping, sometimes a combination of these two. And then see, again, I'm over here. I'm trying to separate the posterior plate with this. It's not separating. So I have held the nucleus there and then I'm separating it. So now, so once this posterior plate is separated, the job becomes much, much easier. So this surgery is actually unedited in the things that I'm showing. So this is at real time speed. Don't do too much lateral movement, as I had said, because if you do that, there's a chances that you may damage the PC. Even if it's a hard cataract, if you know how to do it, you can do it in 2 or 3 minutes, the entire phaco is done. And in normal cataracts, you can finish it in 1 minute, less than a minute. This is very important. Rotate the nucleus as I'm doing over here. Push it or pull it, whatever, but you don't need to come out of the eye. If you're injecting a high molecular weight dispersive OVD, that's a good thing, then you need to come out of the eye. Now what you see over here is, since that posterior plate did not separate, you can see that it is lagging behind. And that can actually damage the PC. So it would be better if I would have separated that and then moved on with this. You see, the part posterior plate was not separated there. So this is going, it's again and again doing. So here, for beginners, inject OVD inside the eye, as I have showed in the previous video. So we move on to the next video now. This is a direct chop in such cases. So, and the thing is, the difference between doing topical phaco in mature black cataracts, hard cataracts, it doesn't matter. If the patient is cooperative, you can do it. Yes, beginner surgeons do under block, but it's not that difficult. So once this is done, again, okay, we'll see this part, this video. So this rotation is done after doing hydro dissection, and So you create, clear out any loose matter that is there. And see, I'm giving FECO power, going inside, and now I've held the nucleus, and then I'll be doing vertical chopping. Let's look at where I'm doing the vertical chopping. So it's quite to be close over there, and the movement, look, notice my movement as it is. So once this is done, so this is about, this is the AMO compact machine only that I'm doing, using a straight tip. And the settings would be about 30, 32, 34 flow rate. The vacuum would be around 450 panel. 450 panel, do not do on compact unless you are very confident about it. And power is about the greater than nucleus, which I don't remember. And yeah, that's it. So again, holding, going inside with some FECO power and then doing the chop. Trying to separate as much of the posterior plate fibers as it is. If there are any air bubbles for beginner surgeons, you can go come out of the eye, remove them, and then do it. Don't try to be you know, a big hero in such cases. And again, see the rotation as I'm doing, pushing it with the chopper. So this is all unedited stuff. This is real-time FECO, no fast-forwarding, nothing that I've done. Yes, the machine is important, but it's more important about the surgeon of how he's doing. So any machine, you can do black cataracts and brown cataracts. This is done, and then you just eat the epinucleus and do your case. So you black cataracts, again, it is the same thing. I'm doing a crater and chop. I'll just stick to this. So this again, as I showed the same video, multi-quadrantic hydrodissection is done. A crater is created. Now this is a combination. So I started off with a horizontal and then I moved on to a vertical chop. So as you can see, this case is under topical anesthesia. Going to the other side and then separating it. So you don't, again, as I said, no, not much lateral movement. So there will be sometimes the posterior plate fails to separate. So we'll see in this video. I think this is that video only. So multiple small pieces are made in such cases. Sorry for the video being decentered. So you start eating, and basically there is, yeah. So you see the central part is not completely separated. That's the plate part. So you can also go with the FECO probe, be a little careful, pick it up, or basically you can inject OBD, float it up a little bit away from the PC, and then you can eat it. I generally prefer to go inside the eye once and come out. So there are some intraoperative challenges. Now let's go to mature cataracts. So that is, what happens is, so intraoperative challenges with mature cataracts. So because when they're intermittent, there's a chances of the extension. As you can see in the video, the Argentina flag can take place. There can be extensions. In mature cataracts, the nucleus may be big, may not be big, may be leathery, may not be leathery, or may be brown, may not be brown. And again, energies, it, according to the grades, so you have to be careful. And the same things as I had. So let's take a look at this video of a mature intumescent cataract that I'm doing. This is unedited video. This is done in about 11 minutes, the surgery. I'll skip that part. Okay. So after making this, the rexus is done. Sometimes after staining, rexus is done. Sometimes if it's not swollen too much, you can actually get away with doing a normal rexus, but otherwise you have to think of other options. So once the Rexis is done, hydro is done, nucleus rotation is checked, and let's get to the phaco part. So in such cases, I would prefer to do just vertical chopping and direct chop. It doesn't look that hard to me. Held the nucleus, as I showed in the previous video, brown cataract did a vertical chop. This is done. Rotate the nucleus and you can chop it more. Similar things, I'll move on to the next video. So this is a case of a mature intumescent cataract. So here you can see that the Rexis has a tendency to run away. So what you have to do is sometimes, as I said, you have to be a little more careful. Again, inject OVD. Some people also prefer to aspirate with a cannula. Some people also, what they do is, the first thing that they do is with a 26 gauge needle, they go inside and puncture the capsule and then aspirate some fluid. What you do want is to basically decompress this zone, because this is because you want to make the PC AC ALC flat. If it is not flat, the chances of extension are there. So over here, as you can see, yeah. So the forces are also, you have to pull towards the center. Otherwise, if you do it like a normal case, it is bound to extend. And then removing this intumescent matter, this loose lens matter, which is, you know, causing the obtuseness of the anterior lens capsule, that matter is removed. Once that is done, then you can go ahead and basically make a cut with the micro scissors or any Vana scissor. And then you can use a Utrata forceps and basically make the Rexis a little bit bigger. The Rexis is the most important part in such cases. You can use a cystitome also if you're comfortable with, but in such cases where the lens matter has been aspirated, it's you know, it becomes more easy with the Utrata. And then you can do your routine echo. So this is also the AMO compact that has been used. This is how you do a vertical chop. So this isn't that hard, and you can eat the machine, the nest of the nucleus. In cases of this, again, let's take a look. So I made a nick over here, and what I do is I try to get a flap at least as much as possible. Once that is done, now you can go inside, you can aspirate. And you can see in this case, I'm able to do most of my Rexis just with a cystitome. So that is possible. But what you can do is you can aspirate this milky fluid, or you can just put OVD on top of it. You can put visco. In such cases, it is a good idea to use a cohesive OVD to flatten in such intumescent lenses or hypermature lenses. Basically, you can flatten the ALC with using a cohesive OVD and then do it. So this was done with the Hummingbird machine. And again, a direct chop was done. I'll skip this part. So this another case, let's take a look at this one. Okay, so this is cataract. So I'm basically creating a crater over here. And so far the surgery is going routinely. There's no problem at all. I'm using the AMO compact here. The J&J compact now. So you go inside, hold it there, and basically then you do a chop. See, the hold was superficial. That is why I was unable to separate it in the way I wanted it. So your hole has to be deeper in the densest part of the nucleus, and that is only when you will be able to separate properly. This is not separating the way I wanted it. The posterior plate is not separated properly. Here I got the posterior plate, but look at the leathery nature of the fibers. And what the thing that is happening over here is that the lens is touching on the iris, and that will result in the iris becoming, you know, being touched, the pupil will become smaller. So you need to be very careful in such cases when the iris is, you know, constricting, the pupil is constricting rather. So you need to be very careful that whenever phaco energy that you're giving has to be in the center, not in the iris. Yes, over there I'm holding and bringing it to the center, but you have to be very careful. See, holding it, the entire chopping is then, since the pupil is becoming constricted, it will be very difficult to do horizontal chopping. Then you have to shift to vertical chopping. And again, as I say, the phaco has to be done in the center only, not do it in the don't do it in the periphery. Otherwise, you will end up in trouble. If there are any problems that you are facing and you are unable to do it, do not hesitate to put, pupil expanding device like an iris hook or a ring or whatever. Iris hooks do better in such cases when you've already started. And see, you can do vertical chopping, but if you're not confident enough, please put iris hooks. It will make your surgery has to be made as easy as possible. Once you do that, the result will be good. If you are making life difficult for yourself, never do that for any surgery. Always choose the easiest way. Easiest way to give the best result for the patient. If there are two ways, there's an easy way and there's a difficult way, but both are giving equally good results, then choose the easy way. That's what I'm trying to say. Don't try to be heroic. So again, you can see everything is done in this center part over here. Multiple times you can inject OBD. You can reduce your vacuum a little bit in such cases. See, I got hold of the iris, but I was very lucky that the nucleus prevented it from getting damaged. Okay, so this is done. And then better thing would be to inject adenine also in the eye, in the middle. So if it dilates with adenine, good enough. So these are the things that I said, phaco probe in the center, protect the iris, phaco in iris plane, then vertical chopping, and don't be in a hurry. Moving on, next is the Argentinian flag sign. So this happens basically when the spontaneous tear in the anterior capsule extends to the periphery. The appearance of a stained capsule is there between the white cataract. So it mimics the Argentinian flag, that's why known as the Argentinian flag sign. So why does it happen? Because if you look at the photo that I have shown, there is some dense matter over here. And therefore, there's anterior displacement of the iridol lens diaphragm. And these are basically centrifugal forces that are play at applicable there, and basically extension takes place to the periphery. So basically because of the high lenticular pressure. So as I showed in various techniques that you need to decompress it. Once you decompress this thing, or you flatten the ELC with using Vispo or Helon or a gel, whatever, and flatten it, and then you will be able to do it better. So how to prevent it is basically that you need to choose the correct OBD, highly cohesive one, maintain the AC deep as possible, double dexis. Another thing is known as the onion peel dexis or spiral dexis, where you start off small, and like an onion peel, you increase it slowly to make it bigger. Decompress the glap and the bag, and some people do use mannitol. I prefer not to use mannitol in such cases. So here you can see over here that this has happened, and you just saw. Just I was trying to putting Visco, and this resulted in an Argentinian flag in this video. So again, in such cases, what you need to do is you need to cut over here and basically cut it, and then you need to use a Rexis forceps or a micro Rexis forceps after cutting with a tangential cut with a micro scissors. So it's a good idea to have such instruments in your OT tray. Micro scissors and micro Rexis forceps do help a lot. And this is how you do it. And similarly, you do it for the other side. So when you do have an Argentinian flag, while doing FECO, you need to be doing direct chop is more because you don't want to put any pressure and extension can take place to the posterior. So basically, direct chop is what is preferred, minimal manipulation and minimal lateral separation, like all hard down cataracts. So if you look at this case over here, going inside, I'll skip this part. Okay. Yeah. So I started the Rexis. The lens is sometimes so intermittent. So it happens to the best and the most experienced surgeons as well. If it's going to happen, you can't do that. But what you need to do is, as the things that I have said, you need to try to minimize it if it's possible. And the flag has already occurred. So over here, I'm basically trying to decompress it little, as much as possible. Still milky fluid is coming. And I'm now trying to aspirate as much as possible. This it would have been better if I would have used the cannula rather than the Simco, because this can actually, in this superior part near the wound, it can cause an extension there as well. So once you do that, basically, then you can cut in the picture that I have shown and convert it to a Rexis. So when you're doing FECO over here, okay, so you're going with the, one second, yeah. Okay, so once you're doing FECO in such cases, direct chop is what is preferred. Even if it's a leathery cataract, be very careful. Hold the nucleus. And this is a horizontal and then convert it to a vertical chop. So it's basically a combined chop that I'm doing. See, the posterior plate fibers are not separated. And what is going to happen is going to make my surgery difficult. So that is what your aim should be, to separate till the posterior plate. So you will see now, see how much manipulation I'm doing in such case. I'm trying to separate, make it as much as possible. And you can see the lens, how much it has gone like this. So you don't want actually this situation. So try to separate in the posterior plate. I'm continuing with the FECO, but I'm being a little bit more careful over here. This is done. So this is another case. In such cases, it's a small, it's a grade 4 mature cataract with a corneal opacity. So a good idea over here would be to place hooks, as I have done. I prefer to use 5 hooks. And now you can see there is an anterior lens capsule plaque is there. So I'm trying to do Rexis. Again and again injecting OVD, using multiple ports where I make to do this Rexis. If there's a plaque and the Rexis has to go through that area, remember that you will not be able to do Rexis to that area. So you have to cut with the scissors if there is a plaque. And if sometimes the plaque is not cutting with the scissors also, use a side port knife, use a MBR, use a keratome to cut it. You see the plaque. Then again, multi-quadrantic hydrodissection is done. After every time, tap in the center, because you don't want the fluid to be formed in the between the PC and the lens. And if this happens, the fluid, you don't decompress the bag, what can happen is a pupillary snap and then the lens will drop because the PC has given away because of the increased fluid and the pressure between the PC and the lens. Now you see over here, this is again the AMO compact that I'm using. I'm trying to do a direct chop over here. So I did separate a little bit, not sure as to what is happening because of the opacity. Nazmul, I'll take 10 more minutes if it's okay.
Right, sir. You can continue. Please, sir.
So see, over here, what I've done is I've used 2 hands. I'm unable to separate with the FECO probe. So then I've used 2 hands, a dyer and a chopper, or 2 choppers, and then I separated it like I would do in a stop and chop over here. So since my visibility is a bit compromised, then I'm, again, let's look at it, trying to separate, not able to get it. I want to separate to that posterior plate because particularly visibility is not there. So over here, I use a dyer and a chopper and separated it till the posterior plate. If that is done, surgery becomes much, much more easy and you can do your FECO in the normal way. But again, in such cases also, FECO has to be done in the center. not in the periphery or the mid periphery. You can bring, see the piece there in the periphery or mid periphery, bring it to the center. Chop you can do in the mid periphery or this, but then bring it to the center and then do your thing. So if you're using, you know, if you're not careful so much, and if there's a smaller incision than what you would want, we see if you make a bigger incision, there'll be wound leak, so you can have surge. You don't want that. But don't make a too small incision where it just, you know, snugly fills and it's causing damage to the thing. And any phaco injury that comes out to the wound, with the phaco power on, if you the picture like this in a wound burn, and then you have to close this eye with the suture. So sometimes what happens is posterior capsular rent can occur during phaco. Okay, so this can occur in trenching, it can occur in phaco, last piece phaco, you can have surge also at any time of the surgery. So over here, see, I'm doing my phaco, no problem at all, routine surgery going on. No issue at all. Completely. Surgery is almost done. Couple of seconds done and I have to just do an IA and I have to close the, basically, then put the IOL and then close the eye. But suddenly, something has happened. I notice, oh, there's a rent. How did it happen? So let us see this in slow motion. So what has happened is, when doing phaco, because the PC was not pushed back, it came and it caught the probe. So again, as I'm saying, in last piece phaco, I would recommend to put visco or any HPMC is also fine. Push that PC back and then do it. So if this is there now, again, don't come out of the eye. Don't come out of the eye, extremely important. Lower the bottle height from the second hand or with the second instrument, inject OVD inside to flatten that vitreous or push that vitreous back. Any OVD is fine. If you have visco to autocoat, that's better. Otherwise, push it back and keep it in position so that the vitreous collapse is minimized, and then bring your phaco probe out. If you bring the phaco probe out suddenly, immediately the rent will increase. So let's take a look at this. So it depends on what stage of the surgery that has happened in this. So I'm doing phaco over here. This is a hard brown cataract. Doing a direct chop, separating. Now you notice the mistake I'm doing. I'm doing too much lateral separation. This is what I was saying. Too much lateral separation can be a recipe for disaster. So far I have not noticed it, and the air bubble is there in the center. So these are my mistakes. I have not realized. Again, too much lateral separation I'm doing. So I'm doing phaco. So far, not realizing anything. Everything is going well. Separated over here. This phaco is also, this machine, this part is also eaten. And then I note, oh, that the piece, one piece has gone back behind the PC. Something has happened. Something is there. See, it's behind the PC over here and it is floating. So next thing that I'm doing is, as I said, I don't want more vitreous collapse. Let's see if we can take that out or not, but don't fetch that nucleus as any probe. The only thing that you can use is a cutter to eat it. OVD is injected. Bring the lower the bottle height. Whenever you have a rent, remember your parameter should be reduced. Reduce the flow rate. Reduce the vacuum. Reduce the power. Basically, do slow motion fit. So then over here, I realized that okay, so there is a small rent over here. This part, the superior aspect, because I'm doing temporal phaco. So the next thing is, I don't want more nucleus. Anything that is going to drop, I don't want that. So I'm going to prolapse this nucleus out. So the decision to convert to SICS or to ECC depends on what is the current situation of that eye. So I'm prolapsing it, little bit I have prolapsed, then I'm using a dialer and I'm using a repositor. Since the rent is in this periphery, so I can't put an IOL just like that. So I made an SICS, used the Vectis, took it out, and then I'll do the vitrectomy part. So now since the rent was in the periphery, it's difficult to put the lens, make it stable, and then do it. If it was in the center, you can prolapse the nucleus, heminucleus if it's there, out, put the IOL in the back, so that acts as a scaffold, known as the IOL scaffold technique, and then you can do your phaco in the anterior chamber. So this is the AMO, again, the electric cutter that I'm using, and see, while cutting only, with the the drop piece came up, and therefore I was able to eat it. In such cases, Post-operative day one, if the cornea is clear, do a dilated fundus examination. Preferably get it checked by a VR colleague if there is one in the hospital. Because you need to document these things, because any dropped nucleus cortex, this brings inflammation inside the eye. And then the vitrectomy is done as you would normally do. The cutter is used. And prefer to put three-piece IOL in such cases. Sometimes it's not available of that power. Something is there. So I prefer to put a rigid three-piece IOL because I had option of one and it was available of that power. And I put it in the sulcus. A good thing in managing such cases would be to put the IOL in the sulcus and do in the tap in the center and do a capture. Capture meaning the haptics are in the sulcus, the optics is in the back and the lens will not rotate. Situation. If you look, this is a black cataract. Okay. Black and I'm doing topical only. So I've done. I'm doing phaco. So far, so good. No issue. Again, too much lateral separation. These are all my earlier videos. Again, and the nucleus has become vertical. And I notice, you know, there's something wrong. The nucleus is tilting. There is something wrong inside the eye. In that eye, ideally, I should have put visco and then come out. But I didn't do that. That was my mistake. Now I see there is a rent. So what I'm trying to do is I'm going to prolapse this nucleus. And there's a chance that this nucleus is dropping. If I make a tunnel right now, in such a situation, I'm using a repositor or something to bring it out into the AC. Again, AuroCoat is put to push it back. You can see that there is vitreous over here at this section. I've cut this with the scissors. And see, I've not put a block. In such cases, if you have difficulty, you can always give a subcutaneous block. But I've not converted to a block. I'm doing it topical only. And with the keratome, I've converted it into an ECC. So ECC, the problem is the astigmatism part is a lot. So it will be difficult for you guys to manage the astigmatism part. So suturing has to be good. Okay. And within 1 month, I remove all the three sutures that I put in the OPD only. So using two hands, I'm able to bring this nucleus out. Complications can happen. Don't be scared of them. Just manage them properly. Every surgeon has complications. If any surgeon says, I don't have complication, that means that surgeon is not operating in many cases or not operating at all. So this is done. Once this is done, vitrectomy was done and the IOL was also placed. So I placed the IOL in the bag only in such a case. Alcon IQ lens, it was there. I put it in the bag. If it's in the sulcus, then you should put a 3-piece IOL and not this. And then this was sutured. Three sutures were put and they were removed later on by 1 month. So this video is courtesy of Dr. Nikunj Tank. So this is not a grade 4 cataract as we were discussing, but I wanted to show this video. So over here, you see the surgeon is doing the surgery is routine. No problem at all. Everything is going well. I've shown a similar video before. In this presentation, and you see what happened. The PC got stuck, so you should have put visco and pushed it back. So now push OVD inside, come out of the eye, and then basically do the, as I said. So PCR management, it depends on what stage. If there's a large nuclear fragment that is there in a hard brown cataract, ideally convert to an SICS or a DCC. If there's a smaller fragment, bring it in the AC, remove it through the main port. And then change your settings in any case. You can do FACO, but control settings or reduce settings. IOL scaffold can be done, particularly if there's a small or one-third or nucleus is remaining. Any cortex, you'd use dry aspiration or remaining cortex in case of a rent. You do dry aspiration, you do controlled aspiration, or you can use the IA cut mode that is available in the vitrectomy machines. So any nucleus drop, if you have, remember, don't fetch it. Close the eye, do a good anterior vitrectomy, suture the eye, and give it to the VR surgeon. If you are sending a case with a nucleus drop or anything drop, remember to suture all the ports, even including the side ports as well, because the VR people will be inserting trocars inside. So that wound can give away. But if it is sutured, vitrectomy is done nicely, or anterior vitrectomy, it becomes easier for the VR surgeon also. So for automated anterior vitrectomy, suture that and have tight incisions whenever there's a rent. PFR is kept around 10 to 15, vacuum around 200. Cut rate maximum to that machine. I generally prefer that. So split the infusion and the aspiration, that's always better. With the infusion or the irrigation directed towards the angles away from the side of the rent. Cut IA mode used when there is, see, difference between cut IA and IA cut mode is that in two, one is irrigation for both. In the second part of the, when you press the pedal mode, it is in cut IA, it is second part is irrigation plus vitrectomy. And third part is irrigation, vitrectomy plus aspiration. In the IA cut mode is, that is used as retained cortex. And you want to do that also, but vitreous is also coming. Instead of here, the second irrigation and aspiration. So you can remove the cortex, and third is irrigation, aspiration and vitrectomy. So when there's any vitreous coming out, you can use it and cut it all with the same thing as well. Use always, there's a rent, use triamcinolone acetonide, stain the vitreous, it's always better. And after the putting the IO, after the surgery has been done, again stain and check for irritating with vitreous. Visualize the cutting port, that's extremely important before taking it inside the IO. So if a lens like this is there, situation is bad, and these zonules are weak, surgeon is not confident if it is better to do an SICS. SICS gives very good results, no problem. But if the lens is there and if it is not beyond, it is beyond your ability to handle such lenses with phaco, SICS is not bad. Considering post-operative considerations that you have, prolonged surgical time is there, so be careful of them. So the take-home messages are that it's not for beginners, don't start with down cataract. Do a larger excess than 5.5, multi-quadrantic hydrodissection is important. Soft shell technique should be done. Prefer to do a crater and chop or a stop and chop in such cases. Chopping should be combined or vertical in such cases. Multi-planar chopping is done. Avoid too much lateral separation and separate till the posterior plate, and phaco should be done in the iris plane or in the back. So just the last thing I'll say, conquer your mind. If you conquer your mind, you can conquer the world. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you for this wonderful presentation. It's always a pleasure watching your surgeries and attending your presentations. So we have got a huge amount of participation today. So we'll be requesting participating surgeons to make this session an interactive one. We have also some questions are there in the chat box. So I'd be requesting surgeons, they can unmute and ask questions directly to Dr. Karan. So questions from Dr. Muhammad Shabib. So Dr. Shabib, can you unmute and ask your questions if possible? All right, so I'll be reading out the questions. So what is the difference between high-end machine and low-end phaco machine? Question from Dr. Shabib.
Okay, so the basic differences that would be in the cutting power. The higher-end machines eat better. More important is the fallibility is better. The chamber stability is better in such the higher end machines. So if you can afford the higher end machines are better for this reason, for these three main reasons.
So a question from Dr. Vaibhav. Dr. Vaibhav, you can unmute and ask if possible.
Okay.
Your preferred settings in grade 4 and above.
Okay. So it's about flow rate, as I said, 30 to 34. Something vacuum, see, it depends on the when trenching, the flow rate is slightly lesser than this, around 28 or so. Vacuum is around 40 to 60 in case of trenching, and in trenching, power again is according to the grade of the nucleus. And my thing is set on continuous mode, okay, in while doing this. Coming to chopping or basically quadrant mode where you want to eat the nucleus. Then my flow rate would be around 30 to 34. My vacuum would be in harder cataract should ideally be minimum 380, 390, 400. But mine actually I keep at 450. That is the maximum that you can keep of the compact machine. And I have vacuum set as panel mode. That means, as I explained, the on-off switch, like a light, it directly comes the 100% of what you've selected. For beginner surgeons, don't do that much. 400 vacuum is good enough for you. Keep it in linear mode. And power, again, you can choose either continuous mode or you can choose the burst mode. Burst mode works very well over here. But remember, power again is according to the grade of the nucleus. If it's hard, increase the power. You shouldn't be spending too much dying FACO. Suppose the grade is 4, cataract is there, you're doing 30-40% FACO power. No, make it 60, make it 70, make it 80, doesn't matter. But generally, even hard black cataracts, up to 60% power, you can eat it. Most of the cases, 90-95%, 60% power is more than sufficient. I believe I have asked.
Thank you, sir. So one more question from Dr. Shabib. What machine would you suggest for beginner surgeons?
Okay. So first of all, choose a machine where, you know, the service is good. Okay. And I would prefer to go for standard company machines rather than this. So I can only comment on machines that I have used personally. So for beginner surgeons, I have used the AMO Compact. I have used the Laureate. Okay. First thing is, there is every machine is good for machines also. Okay. It's only a misnomer that you have to buy only a basic machine as a beginner. If you have the money, buy the top of the top. If you don't have the question is not for a beginner surgeon. The question is, what machine should be there if the money is not there? Okay. So then you go for a basic module. So the AMO Compact has been closed. You can go for an Intuitive. I'm still yet to receive the demo of the Intuitive machine, but from various surgeons, I have heard that it is an excellent machine. And see, again, I'm able to do it in compact, not a problem at all. So basic, my exposure has been more with the compact and the Laureate. If you're talking about the basic machines, and both are very good, excellent machines. Okay.
Thank you, sir. So
you can afford the higher end machines, go for it.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Sachin, I would request you to unmute and ask your question, if possible. A question from Dr. Sachin is, kindly explain burst mode settings in hard cataract surgery.
There are three types of mode: pulse, burst, and continuous. So burst basically starts off as a pulse mode. And when you increase it, the off-duty cycle that is there between this, it decreases. As a result of which, at the end, when the foot pedal is completely pressed down, that time burst is the same as continuous. So basically, the off-duty is decreasing, the on-duty is increasing, on-cycle is increasing. That is the difference between burst and continuous. So again, settings is nothing, boss. Harder cataracts, you can use burst mode. Okay, so power is basically according to the grade of the nucleus. That's it.
Right, sir. One more question from Dr. Sachin, sir. Management in Argentinian flag signed in nasal temporal direction other than shown in video.
Okay, nasal temporal, and your incision is where? Suppose you're sitting temporally means, or it's opposite, 90 degrees away. If it means that, see, as I showed in the video, you have the axis. If you don't have the access, again, from another side port, you can make another port, make the cut with the scissors or a micro scissors, and basically convert it into an access. Your aim should be to convert whatever flap is from wherever you had. You can make an extra port and convert it into a access as much as possible. FACO again, direct chopping and away from the site of the flag, because posterior excision can be taking place. So sometimes in such cases, you need to do a little bit anterior chamber FACO rather than in the back.
Thank you, sir. One more question from Dr. SG. Dr. SG, could you please unmute and ask if possible? Sir, I'll be reading out the question. So which chopper do you use? Which one beginner should use?
Okay, so there's no such thing as beginner chopper, okay? There's no difference in that. So I prefer to use sharp choppers, and I've started using, and I have used sharp choppers from the beginning. The chopper that I have used is the Agarwal chopper. Okay, so it's like a triangle. So it has a sharp bottom, which helps me do vertical chopping. And this part also, the triangle, the horizontal part of it, or the basically the stem part of it is also sharp. So that I can do horizontal chopping as well. So this is, initially for softer cataracts or NS2, you can use a smaller chopper. So these choppers are available in various sizes. So you can have small, medium, large. So you can buy all three and use experiment. So this, I really like this chopper. Yeah. Anything else?
Right, sir. Thank you, sir. We have one more question from Dr. Abhishek. Dr. Abhishek, could you please unmute and ask if possible? Sir, please tell FECO machine settings while dealing PCR.
So, see, suppose you're operating a 350 or 400 vacuum, reduce the vacuum to about 250. So, basically like an epinuclear mode, you can say, we reduce the vacuum a little bit more, reduce your FECO power a little bit more, that's it. And reduce the bottle height. If you set a 90 or 100 bottle height, make it 70, reduce it a little bit. That's it, nothing else.
Right, sir. So we have one more question from Dr. SG regarding which gaze vitrectomy probe you use in AMO Compact.
So AMO Compact has the electrical cutter. So it's not 23 gaze. I think it's 20 gaze, right?
So we have 20, 23 and 25 is there, I guess.
Okay. So that's a slightly bigger cutter.
It's 20.
That is not that great. Otherwise, prefer if you are buying a cutter, keep a 23 gauge cutter is always good. It's better to use that, and that's it. This is an electric cutter, and it's, you should always have something, you know, a pneumatic cutter would be good. Something which is working on the Venturi principle would be good. Electric cutter is not great. This is what is available, but if you don't want to buy another machine, it's good enough, and rents are not that common. So then it works nicely. But be careful with such cutters is, I will just say, if there's a small rent, put the lens first and then do the vitrectomy because it extends it. But normally, if it's a better cutter, like the Signature Pro and other machines, they have good, better cutters. So in such a case, then you can do vitrectomy first and then put the IR.
Right, sir. We have one more question from Dr. SG. So, till how much Rexis extension we should proceed for FECO, and what should be criteria to convert to SICS?
That depends on you, how much confident you are. If you are a beginner FECO surgeon, little bit Rexis extension, you can handle it. But if it's, if you are not, if I have done FECO in can openers also, but when there is a Rexis extension, again, you need to be confident in vertical chopping. That is one thing that is important. Converting to SICS, it depends on you. If you feel you cannot do FECO, just convert. No problem. There's no harm. You can put the same lens, what you have planned for, a foldable lens via the bigger tunnel. Not an issue at all. Don't. Whenever there's a thing that it's beyond you, you should always convert. It depends on your skill level. I rarely convert unless there's a big rent, as in the videos that I have shown.
Thank you, sir. So we have one comment from Dr. Amanpreet. He is appreciating you. Beautiful surgical videos. In case with corneal opacity, I would have used a chandelier illumination or lateral illumination, or could have done SICS.
Yeah, absolute. Dr. Amanpreet is saying absolutely correct. A chandelier would be great, but a chandelier is available in the VROT, which I'm not there. So VR is separate in a separate block. So that becomes my challenge. Otherwise, I have not used a chandelier so far, but I would love to use it.
So we have one quick question from Dr. SG. Can you convert it to SICS from the same site as FECO?
See, if you're trying to do an SICS, again, it's a larger incision. I would prefer whether it is same site or where, do it superior. But there's a rent. You want it to be covered. Don't do temporal in such cases. That is what I would prefer. Whether the main entry is superior, you've done superior FECO or temporal FECO, doesn't matter. When you're doing an SICS in rents, it is better to have it covered nicely, lid covering also. So superior incision I would prefer in such cases.
Thank you doctors for your question. So we have one more question.
Tunnel from separate clock R, yes, you can make separate also, you can make same also, but superior.
One question from Dr. Prashant Girish. So, doctor, you can unmute or ask. Regarding Centurion versus Signature Pro for heart cataract.
So, I know him personally. Dr. Prashant, I know him personally. He has taught me also surgeries. Okay, so when we are in Arvind, he's a very good friend. Sir, basically, both are fine, both are good. no difference, I would say. It's your comfort and who you want to, that's your personal call.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant. Thank you, sir. So any more questions from the participating doctors? Dr. Prashant is thanking you, sir. So thank you, doctor, for your question. So we can take one or two more questions Dr. Karan can allow us to extend the session. So doctors, you can unmute and ask if any other queries are there.
Yeah, I have a question. I'm Dr. Jayashree. My question is when there is an Argentinian flag sign or a capsular extension, is there some way of knowing whether it is extending posteriorly or it is just limited, it's going to convert into PCR or it's headed towards PCR in the early stage, right, when you are doing the access?
Ma'am, as far as I'm concerned, I really don't know. I feel that, rarely it really extends to the posterior case. Most of the times it does not extend posteriorly. Way to know, I don't think so. There is any way to know. You will only know once the nucleus is out. Once the thing.
I thought. Anyway, thank you. You showed excellent surgeries, excellent videos. Thank you for your lovely talk.
Thank you, ma'am.
So one more question from Dr. SG. Sometimes we notice undulating PC while FECO. How should we go ahead in such cases?
Undulating PC, matlab? What do you mean by undulating PC, sir?
So, doctor, if possible, you can unmute and ask. So, we can take, sir, if PC is coming in the anterior part of the eye, so we can just continue with this answer. So, because you have one of the very important point about the PC rent. It comes forward and moves backwards. Okay.
You can go ahead. No problem at all. So this PC, when it is coming back, just keep on pushing the, this is regarding, where is the question? Oh, that again. Okay. For that. Yes. So what you need to do is for that case, if the PC is coming up and down, always keep multiple times, inject OVD from the side port, push it back. And you can do your FECO. Don't do it in the bag. Do it in the iris plane. And last piece, you can bring it a little bit up and then do it slightly in the anterior chamber. But the thing is, what I would say is, keep on pushing the visco multiple times to push the PC back.
So Dr. SG, has in addition to this, any change in setting related to that part, parameters?
You just reduce your settings a little bit. Same thing, reduce your vacuum, reduce your flow rate. That's it. I don't think you need to change.
Right, sir. So we'll take, sir, two more questions already there in the chat box, sir. So one from Dr. Rahul Bhatia. There's, sir, any tips for managing thick posterior plates, leathery posterior part, or which is very hard to separate?
Do stop and chop. Do stop and chop or crater and chop. That is why I prefer these techniques, is this. And make the trench wide if you're doing stop and chop. Two probe width. Then that's fine. If you've gone down till about 80-90% depth in such cases, and then you do a chopping, a trencher chop or a crater end chop, then it will separate. It's only 10-20% that is depth. If you've not gone to 80-90% depth, it will not separate.
So we'll take last question from Dr. Fahim. So, sir, maximum power for trenching hard cataract?
There's as much as possible. Whenever there is any pushing effect on the nucleus, the nucleus is being pushed, understand that your power is insufficient. So there's no, you can go 100%, no problem. But the nucleus should not be pushed. So increase your PICO power. 80%, 60%, 70%, 50%, depends on lens to lens.
Right, sir. So before wrapping up, sir, last question from Dr. SG. Any tips to remove PP nucleus and cortex in cases with weak zonules?
Tangential. Suppose the epinucleus, what you can do is you can just do a hydrodissection or a visco. Sometimes if it's not coming, you can do visco dissection also and just bring it out. In cortex, particularly in weak zonules, you have to be tangential when you're doing aspiration. Don't pull to the center and eat. It has to be tangential and then you do it.
Right, sir. So before wrapping up, sir, any final comments and takeaway points from your side for our participants? Surgeons?
Thank you, Nazmul and JNJ, for having me here again. There was a good attendance today. I'm happy about that. And I just hope everybody has learned. And if there's something, you know, you would want to give tips to me also, I'm always ready. We are continuously learning. At the last, I would say it's not that difficult to do hard cataracts. But do NS2 to NS3 first. Become confident in it. And then move on to hard cataracts. Don't jump the gun and go to hard cataracts. It's just some things that you need to change. It's not that difficult. That's it from my end.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Dr. Abhishek is also appreciating you. Thank you, all the participants. Doctors, if any more questions are there, you can share with our JNJ colleagues. We can reach out to you with answers. So we come to an end of our today's session. So it's been a delight to hear you, sir. And thank you for being here today and taking time to enlighten us. And thank you all the participating doctors for patience and active participation to make this session a successful one. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone. Good night. Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.